No, I don't. No, we didn't have strong ties.
What?
Stuff that I'll be doing at the University of Ottawa. My goal, I guess my main goal, is that by the
what I mean when I say how to relinquish moral control to robots and feel good about it. I'll do a quick intro just to give you a sense of my background. Hopefully that'll give you an idea of where I'm coming from, why I'm interested in these type of topics. So I actually started my career as an engineer. I worked for a number of years in aerospace, telecommunications, designing different types of technologies. And I got into philosophy probably about 6-7 years after starting working as an engineer. And really got hooked on some of these problems that we're seeing with technology when we release it into the wild, right? Give it to people, ask them to use it, and then start seeing how it starts to shape, you know, technology starts to shape society. It changes the relationships that we have with the world, with each other, enables certain things, disables certain other things. And so these are topics that have been really driving my research for the past 10 years or so, when I went back and started doing work in philosophy. Where I landed most recently is on robotics and artificial intelligence technologies. So any kind of robotics, any kind of artificial intelligence, and kind of ethical implications of those technologies. And I'll explain a couple of problems tonight that I'm particularly interested in. But I do sort of general. When you do applied ethics, you end up kind of being a generalist with some particular things that you'd like to do. So I'll talk about those things tonight. And I'm also associated with these two organizations. One's the Open Roboethics Initiative at the top. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And the one at the bottom here, I like to put these up just to sort of get people to know about these things that are out there. You can join them. You can follow them online. The Foundation for Responsible Robotics, which just started up in the Netherlands. It's centered in the Netherlands. So you'll have to bear with me. I'm at the end of a cold, so I'll be coughing off and on tonight. And drinking a lot of water. So, all right, so like any good philosopher, I want to start by defining a couple of terms just to make sure we're clear on a couple of definitions. The first is robot. I'll be talking a lot about robots tonight. And this is a pretty basic, straightforward definition that you're going to get of a robot. It's a machine situated in the world. I'm going to allow, you know, a monitor, a computer to be a robot as well. I'll talk about them as robots. Something that can sense, think, and act. And of course, I put those in scare quotes for the philosophers because they're not really sensing. They're not really thinking, they're not really acting in the sense that we want to talk about often in philosophy, but just colloquially speaking, they're sensing, they're thinking, and they're acting. They have sensors, they have processors that are processing information, and then they do things and interact in the world, whether it's through user interfaces or through a physical embodiment moving around, like the robots that you see on TV or that you come across maybe in the real world. Okay. Roboethics, this is the general area that I work in. Some of you have may be familiar with this term, may have come across it, may have come across robot ethics. People talk about robot ethics as well. Roboethics, robot ethics, roughly equivalent. There are three ways that people generally talk about roboethics or robot ethics. The first is the type of ethics that would go into designing these technologies. So this would be the kind of ethics that you might say apply to engineers or designers or computer programmers, the people who are doing the work. What kind of things should they take into consideration? How should they design the technology? So on and so forth. The other way that you can use the term is to talk about the type of ethics, the algorithms, the computer code that you're actually embedding in the technology. So robot ethics might refer to the type of behavior that you're designing this robot or artificial intelligence to engage in. And so that would be the ethics of the actual thing itself rather than the ethics attaching to the people doing the work as in the first sense of the term. The third one is the one, I'll mention it and then I'll very quickly eliminate it. I'll eliminate it right now. It is the sense that people love to talk about the most This is an intelligent robot's own self-chosen code of ethics, right? This is the science fiction-y concern or interest that people have when they think of, like, well, what happens when a robot can love? What happens when a robot is intelligent like a person, has consciousness, things like that? I don't mean to dismiss that as nonsensical or anything like that, but for the purposes of my work, and in order to focus the kind of arguments that I'm interested in looking at, the kind of design questions that I'm interested in engaging in, this actually functions as a distraction most often. We can assume for now that robots aren't intelligent, they don't have consciousness, they don't have these kinds of things. So although that is a sense that people talk about robot ethics, it's certainly not the sense that I'll be talking about it tonight. So I just want you to be aware of what I'm explicitly trying to say right now. So, is roboethics something that we should care about today? Or is it just science fiction? I mean, at first, it may seem like, okay, well, yeah, robot ethics. We don't really have these robots out there. Why is this an issue for us to spend an hour listening? Why is it important enough to waste a couple hours on Thursday night in a room all together? Well, by the end of the talk, I think I hope to have convinced you that this is a topic that deserves attention today for specific reasons, mainly the number one reason is that we're dealing with some issues now in the design of these technologies. That we probably should sort out before we start releasing these technologies into the wild, as it were. Okay. Right, so why should we be concerned about it? Because the robot and artificial intelligence revolution has begun. This is the kind of phrase I want you to keep in your mind. It is not science fiction anymore to talk about robots in the world, to talk about designing robots, to talk about artificial intelligence. This stuff is coming. This stuff is already here. These technologies need to be reckoned with. And I'll give you a few. I'll give you a few details and statistics just to kind of convince you that in fact the robot revolution is underway. Okay, first. Service robots, already a $25 billion industry in the U.S. alone, so that's just in the U.S., okay? That's a lot of money. Service robots, anything from robots that would do things in restaurants, these mail robots that take things around, you've all heard of the Roomba, the little vacuums that go around your house, stuff like that. $25 billion in the U.S. alone. Global medical robotics, this industry is going to grow to $14 billion by 2018. That's the prediction. That's a lot of money. Okay, I would say that that's actually a low ball in the last couple of years. These stats are a little bit old. They're maybe 2-3 years old. They were probably compiled 3-4 years ago. In fact, what we're seeing is a whole other class of medical robotics coming out. In the social robotics world, I'll talk very slightly about that, like little therapy robots that they're designing to work with children, things like that. These are going to be big business very soon. Global annual spending on unmanned aerial vehicles will grow to $11 billion over the next decade. That may even be lowball. This number, again, is old. I think they said they sold close to 100,000. Is it 100,000? I want to say 100,000 small drones, the little remote controlled quadcopters, things like that, like the Parrot AR drone, this Christmas alone in the US. So worldwide, that's a much bigger number. Google, a couple of years ago, announced a $4 billion purchase of robotics companies. They basically went around and bought all the major robotics companies that were for sale at the time. That's a lot of money to spend. They did that within about 6 months. The annual US market for AI systems is estimated to reach $11 billion this decade. So the dollars are adding up. Robots for logistics and manufacturing, $31 billion annually in the U.S. alone by 2020. So this is it. The robot revolution is here. People are designing these things. The technology has advanced to a point where it's actually feasible to have highly autonomous robots in the world. We'll talk a little bit more about that. And they're everywhere. Transportation, medicine, manufacturing, defense and security, entertainment, service, consumer, natural resource extraction, research, exploration. In every aspect of the economy, robotics is taking off. I haven't even talked about the dollars that are being put into research and development in North America and Europe. Europe is dwarfing North America in terms of the R&D dollars that are being put into this. It's in the billions and billions of euros every year. Okay, some examples. This is a standard quadcopter. This is the kind of thing you could buy. Probably, I think this one's about $1,200, something like that. Oftentimes they'll have high definition cameras. They can fly, you know, hundreds of feet into the air. You can get flight packages with autopilot, so you can just kind of tell them where to go and send them out roaming around the neighborhood. Oftentimes people will post videos on YouTube of these things flying around. There have been a lot of near misses. One of these crashed on the president's front lawn about 6 months ago, I think it was. So these things are becoming a concern. You've probably all heard of these. These are the military drones that the U.S. has deployed in various parts of the world. This is one of my favorites, the little internal cardiac defibrillator, a little robotic device that sits inside your chest. It helps to, you know, do the work that those big paddles, you know, the sort of clear the shock paddles. It's a little mini version of that. Helps to sort of restart people's hearts when they go into an abnormal rhythm. This is Cleo. This is a little toy that was popular on the market a few years ago. Little dinosaur robot that was marketed as a kind of robot that you could take care of and teach. And it would grow a little personality. It came in a little egg, and you know, kids could kind of open up the egg and take the Cleo out, and you would be born, and you know, come into the world, and you had to feed it and do all these kinds of things. This is Jibo. It's being marketed as the world's first robotic family member, designed by Cynthia Brazil at MIT. She's one of the world's leading social robotics researchers. So Jibo. I don't know if you've seen the videos or not. Jibo can kind of follow you around, like look around at you while you move around the room, talk to you, interact with you verbally. You can ask it to do things, schedule your tasks, get in touch with people, send emails. They advertise it as being kind of like a babysitter. It'll take care of your kids. It can read your kids' books at night. You know, do all sorts of things like that. So the world's first robotic family member. This is the Da Vinci system. It's a robotic surgery assist robot. So the surgeon would control it from another workstation. And these are the arms with, you know, little tools at the end, little needles and scalpels and whatnot that they can use to get inside and do very fine controlled surgeries within your body. These are becoming more and more popular. They do things like reduce recovery times and things like that, because the incisions are very small and the precision is very fine. This, I don't know if you've seen this. This is a different kind of service robot. Not available yet, per se, but definitely this is kind of a market that people are identifying as a huge potential industry, the sex robot industry. If you Google it, you'll find a lot of information out there about these kinds of things. Of course, this is Jimmy Fallon, caught with his version of one of these. This is Nexi. So Nexi is, again, a social robot designed by Cynthia Brazil. This is kind of a precursor to Jibo. This is social robotics. Roboticists are interested in engaging individuals emotionally through the types of facial expressions and human behavior that you come to expect when you're interacting with people on a personal level. So this kind of research is designed to kind of hook you emotionally and get you to form an emotional bond with the robot that you're interacting with. And of course, this is the Google car. Raise your hand if you've heard or seen the Google, heard of or seen the Google Card video before. Okay, so you know, when I asked that question 2 years ago to my class, a couple people might have put their hand up. 3 years ago, probably nobody had heard of the Google Card. Everybody's heard of the Google Card now. I mean, it is just it's a technology that is currently on the roads in California. It's coming. We don't know when you'll be able to buy your own version of these, but every major auto manufacturer is currently designing their version of the Google Car. Estimates are that in places like California, where it's sunny and dry most of the time, you may be able to get one of these things or have a fleet of these things on the road within 10, 15 years or so. Although estimates vary. Like I said, they already have fleets of these things on the road, but they're strictly for testing, right? Okay, and I'll be talking much more about the Google cars. So hopefully I've convinced you that this kind of makes sense to say something like this. The robot and artificial intelligence revolution has begun. Okay, the good thing about robots, and I won't even go into the details here, I think we can all imagine just offhand the benefits that these things will offer society. If you think just about driverless cars, you can imagine, the promise anyway, is that there will be many fewer accidents. If we have, the more driverless cars we have on the road, the fewer accidents we will have, fewer injuries, fewer deaths. And that's a good thing. And for those of us who are wise enough to realize that humans are terrible drivers, this just seems to make sense. Lower infrastructure costs, right? You think about a robot car, it doesn't need stoplights, it doesn't need lane markers, it doesn't need all these kind of things that human drivers need, guardrails, all that kind of stuff. So you lower the infrastructure costs significantly. You lower your insurance costs significantly if you lower the accident rates. You can talk about increased mobility for young people, for the elderly, and for anyone who has a disability that prevents them from driving a car today, or who has to rely on sort of public transportation, which is cumbersome for people who can't drive their own cars. So there are, just focusing on driverless cars, there are a number of social benefits that we can imagine that robotics and artificial intelligence will bring. What we hear about lately in the news, however, is stuff like this. We have Stephen Hawking, Elon Musk, Bill Gates, and a number of other people. These are just headlines that I pulled. I think one's from The Guardian, one's from The Washington Post. BBC is the other one. With Bill Gates and Elon Musk, these are leading technologists talking about the threat that AI could pose to humanity if left unchecked, or if designed along the current trajectory that we're designing. Now, look at the one up at the top. Stephen Hawking warns artificial intelligence could end mankind. That's not a passive worry, right? Like these are strong words coming from someone who the world looks to for guidance on scientific and intellectual issues. Elon Musk, who is currently he's the CEO of Tesla. Tesla's designing driverless cars. Artificial intelligence is our biggest existential threat. These are major concerns that they have. So let me try to put some color to this narrative to try to explain what they're talking about. And hopefully to put it in perspective through the rest of the talk. One thing that they're concerned about is this increasing tendency to connect devices. So you may have heard of the Internet of Things. The trend in computing and technology is to connect devices together. So cars will be talking with one another. They'll also be talking with your iPhone. They'll be talking with your Fitbit. Excuse me. They'll be talking with your refrigerator at home. Any device that you have will be talking to every other device. They're all connected to the internet. This is the vision that designers have for the future of technology. It's the Internet of Things, connectedness. obviously this raises concerns about security of data, where the data is flowing. It raises concerns about distributed computing. All of these things will be relatively dumb compared to the computing power on the cloud-based services, like at Google, at IBM, wherever they are renting space and launching these the kind of systems that help to manage these the Internet of Things. So there's data flowing all over the world, and everything's distributed in terms of where the knowledge is. Okay, so that's the Internet of Things. And this feeds into this distributed computing power, this collection of things all connected together, feeds into this kind of picture that they paint about super intelligent machines. Okay, I say super in brackets because you know, there's a trajectory that we're on where we could say that things are generally becoming more sophisticated, our technologies, and we could say that they're becoming intelligent. So here's a basic sketch, just using a couple of examples of computers or artificial intelligences, robots, if you want to call them that, that have been in the news in the last couple of decades. That kind of gives a short history of where we've come from and where we might be going in terms of the sophistication and intelligence of AI. So in 1997, Deep Blue, which was an IBM creation, beat one of the world's best chess players, Garry Kasparov, in the game of chess. Right? People predicted this could never be done. Deep Blue did it in 1997. Deep Blue is what you'd call a brute force problem solver. It used, so it used its computing power to calculate based on the situation on the board, all possible moves going forward to a certain number of moves forward, calculate the statistical likelihood that any one move was going to increase its chances of winning, and that's how it played the game of chess. People can't do that kind of computation in their head. Critics said, up till Deep Blue's emergence, that to win a game of chess is just not going to happen because people are intuitive. They'd say things like this. Our intuition is better than any kind of computer. That kind of number crunching doesn't matter. People can adapt. They can change their gameplay. Deep Blue beat Garry Kasparov. So, IBM Watson. Who's heard of IBM Watson? Another IBM creation. IBM Watson was designed to understand and process natural human language, so sentences, paragraphs, the kind of language that we read, as opposed to coded language, which is what computers tend to try to churn through. So most medical charts are like coded charts, right? Like you have specific numbers for a pulse and things like that. IBM Watson was able to understand natural language in a way that people said, a computer will never be able to understand natural language. It understood it so well that when they put IBM Watson up against two of the best human Jeopardy players, Jeopardy, you know, the game show. This was Watson's debut to the world. It played man versus machine two nights on Jeopardy against Brad Rutter and Ken Jennings, the two biggest all-time winning humans of the game of Jeopardy, and IBM Watson destroyed them. It was a no contest. It looked a little sketchy for the first few questions, and then immediately Watson just started winning everything. And it wasn't even close by the end of the game. Fast forward, so that was in 2011. We've seen something emerge lately called deep learning. I'll get into this a little bit more. This changes the game. Deep learning is actually what, it's the approach to doing AI that prompted these fears from the likes of Bill Gates and Elon Musk. I'll talk a little bit more about that. But then, you know, we have deep learning now. The fear is that the next generation of AI, now that we have deep learning, could reach this point of super intelligence. It could become more intelligent than humans. And when it does become more intelligent than humans, then certain things will happen. Things will come into, the AI will be able to predict things. It will be able to figure things out in a way that we don't really understand. And that's a fear. what prompts Stephen Hawking, Bill Gates, to say that AI poses an existential threat to humanity. Once it gets to a point where we don't understand what the technology is doing, because it's better than us at doing certain things, we will be forced to relinquish the control to it. There's a very straightforward narrative that you can imagine that would say to us, you know, look, if it's a better driver, let it do the driving. Look, if it's better at diagnosing diseases in the hospital, let it do the diagnostics. If it's better at playing chess, let it play chess, right? I co-authored an article with a friend of mine about IBM Watson. We started off the piece by saying, look, if you're playing Jeopardy, and the creators of Jeopardy let you call a friend during the game to get an answer, there's only one number that you would call, it's Watson, right? It only makes sense. Watson is the best Jeopardy player, right? So once it gets better, than the average human, there's a straightforward narrative you can imagine where we'll feel forced to relinquish control to these things. The worry, though, is that once we relinquish control, we lose it. So how do we maintain control? So here's a great quote from one of the pioneers of artificial intelligence research, Stuart Russell. To those who say, well, we may never get to human level or super intelligent AI, I reply, it's like driving straight toward a cliff and saying, let's hope I run out of gas soon. Right? We're putting a lot of faith on this idea that we'll just never get there. Just like we said, a computer will never win at chess. A computer will never be able to understand natural language to win at Jeopardy. Okay, so here's a straightforward objection that I hear from people when I pose this kind of information to them. It's like, why not just program the robots to be predictable and controllable? Why are you doing this? Why are you, engaging in this kind of design activity? And I want to explain why people do this by getting into talk about robot autonomy. Okay, so let's get back to this picture. I'll go into a little more detail on deep learning now. So deep learning is a different kind of programming activity. Okay? It's not like the kind of programming that you may have done in high school or grade school, where you say, it's all deterministic. You know exactly what the next step is that the program's going to step through. It steps through the program. You can debug it by stepping through programs. Like, you can almost predict what the bugs are if you're looking at the code closely enough. Deep learning is different. Different kind of approach. It uses a neural network approach where they set up these kind of networks. It's kind of trying to model the brain. Networks of millions or billions of nodes meant to almost model brain cells, synapses, things like that. And the way that you do, you design a system with the deep learning approach is you set up algorithms to teach the computer what's going on. So you reinforce positive things that you want to reinforce and discourage things that you want to discourage. Basically, you compile a huge data set that's representative of doing an activity well or properly. You feed it to this deep learning algorithm, and the deep learning algorithm learns. It's a machine learning approach. It learns how to do whatever task it is that you're assigning. It takes relatively few lines of code. So you might think that in order to program a car to drive by itself on the highway would take millions of lines of code, right? Microsoft Word is tens of millions of lines of code just to get a Word document formatted and printed. But to get a car to drive on the highway these days takes a few thousand lines of code using deep learning algorithms as opposed to these millions of lines of code. And this is what allows these systems to demonstrate novel solutions to problems that we're trying to get it to solve. And that's important for reasons that I'll get into in a minute. The novel solutions, the ability of the adapt in ways that people can't predict is what makes these systems successful when navigating the real world. So what I like to say is that robots and AI are increasingly unpredictable by design. It's not a bug that we can't tell what they're going to do next. We do that for a very specific reason, and that's how we gain the benefits from these systems. And this is basically the logic behind that. So in order for us to realize the benefits of robotics, these systems will need to function in less constrained environments, right? So if you have a Roomba trying to vacuum your room, it goes through a sort of algorithm, it maps your room, and then it knows where to go, it knows where the walls are, things like that. That's a relatively constrained environment. You put a car out on the road to drive around for a while, you know, it needs to be able to adapt to all sorts of different conditions, largely in social environments. It's interacting, these robots are interacting with people, other drivers, pedestrians, and people are unpredictable, people are kind of random. So we need this kind of increased autonomy in order to function in these environments. And more autonomy requires this kind of adaptability, right? The less constrained the environment, the more adaptable the system has to be. Partly because there's this exponential increase in the possible number of inputs. You couldn't possibly code every possible driving condition into a Google car. It's impossible. It's too many driving conditions. The car needs to have some way of just adapting. And that's what deep learning accomplishes. Okay? So the greater the adaptability or autonomy of the system, the less predictable that system will be. Now that has all sorts of interesting implications for responsibility, like who's responsible when these systems do things. I wouldn't even get into that. That's a whole area of research that nobody really knows what to do with yet. It's a tough question. But getting back to this objection, why not just program robots to be predictable and controllable to avoid this whole superintelligence problem? The answer is because we have to give up on some or even a lot of predictability and controllability in order to gain the benefits that we're looking for with these systems. And autonomous cars are a perfect example of this, right? They operate in highly unconstrained social environments. They require these deep learning algorithms in order to succeed. Therefore, they're unpredictable by design. This is just a characteristic that they have. The end result is that they should be better than human drivers. But this is a problem, this statement here, that I'll get into shortly. And I want to step away from this talk of machine intelligence to start looking at that, at some of that problem that I'm alluding to in that last line. And these are today's ethical challenges. So the superintelligence trajectory that we're on is a worry for tomorrow. Things that we have to start looking at today in order to hopefully avoid some of those superintelligence issues. That's what I'm interested in. So the rest of the talk, I'll kind of refocus on that, using what I've talked about as far as the context. Okay, what are we automating when we automate driving? There are a bunch of different kinds of functions. There are driving functions, like accelerating, braking, turning, object avoidance, changing lanes, things like that. There are all these sensor functions, object detection, lane detection, traffic light status, that kind of thing. We have to code the traffic rules into these cars, right? Like a red light means stop. The speed limit, when you see that sign, that means that there's a speed limit and you shouldn't go past this speed. These are all complicated and technical problems to solve. But in a way we can imagine straightforward solutions to those types of problems. There's this other thing going on, though, that engineers and designers are having to grapple with now that they don't always recognize they're doing, and that's that they also need to automate ethical decision-making in these systems. Okay? The automation this scale with previous technologies. Okay? Most technology historically works in highly constrained environments. Right? Even computers, like before the internet, you had a computer, it sat in a room or on a under a desk. It wasn't connected to anything, the data was there, it didn't move around, it couldn't, there was no Facebook, there were none of these concerns about privacy, security, all those kind of things that we have now. But now we're having to deal with increasingly automating ethical decision making. And the novel problem that comes up in this context is how do we do that? There are some features of ethical decision making that make it particularly difficult to automate. So let me look back at some classic examples of ethical decision making. And these are the ones that are used in a lot of the driverless car literature. These classic trolley problems. Who's heard of these classic trolley problems before? Oh, good. Okay, so I don't even have to, so you've got the switch, and there's a trolley coming towards one for five people, and you have to decide whether to divert it. Right, and then there's the footbridge in the bottom right. Instead of throwing the switch, you've got to push the person, and that'll stop the trolley. Okay, most of you are familiar with these, okay? These are classic types of ethical decision making that we use in beginner philosophy classes, right? They're usually used to kind of raise these interesting theoretical concerns. They're not imagined as practical problems, right? These are kind of the things that philosophers think about just to have fun conversations in class, to get clear on concepts that have to do with their theories, to impress each other, whatever they're doing with this stuff. Now, moral psychology recently has turned an empirical eye to these things. Yes, no, this matters because we can figure out what's going on in our brain, psychologically speaking. When we think about these classic trolley problems, when we engage in ethical decision making. But what's interesting about robotics and artificial intelligence is that they take these theoretical concerns and they make them very practical problems that we need to solve. So these unavoidable crash scenarios where a car is barreling along and someone runs out into the road and it has to decide, do I swerve into oncoming traffic? Do I hit the person? Do I run into the stroller on the sidewalk? These scenarios will need to be coded into the technology somehow, right? Driving, being unpredictable, will still involve unavoidable crash scenarios. And when these decisions, when they have to be coded, that's the automation of ethical decision making. So I use one problem in some of the work that I've done to illustrate a very important concept, I think, that we need to grapple with when we're dealing with the design of these technologies. So I'm interested in the design. So this is what I call the tunnel problem. Here's how it goes. I've tried to eliminate the kind of consequentialist one versus five problems and pare it down to try to get at a very specific point that I want to make. So again, this is a philosopher's tool. I'm using this to kind of focus the discussion on one thing that I'll get to shortly. But this is the setup. You're the sole passenger in an autonomous car traveling along a mountain road. Suddenly, a child errantly runs into the road, effectively blocking the entrance to the tunnel. Totally plausible, right? The car is you're supposed to laugh. The car is unable to brake safely and has but two options, hit and kill the child or swerve into the wall of the tunnel entrance, killing you. How should the car be programmed to react, right? Because somebody has to program this. Now, as unlikely as this seems, you can imagine similar scenarios that involve these kind of value trade-offs. And there are two questions that are important that I think come up immediately when you think of this, when you think of designing the car faced with these types of scenarios that you can imagine happening. One is, how should the car react? That's the standard question that we ask, when we pose these kind of philosophical problems. What would you do? How would you react to this situation, right? There's this other interesting problem, though, that has gotten a lot less attention. At least it's what I started writing about a few years ago to raise But I posed it as a question: who should decide? How do we go about deciding who decides? And that was what my dissertation was all about, that second question. Okay. The reason it's problematic, and maybe more problematic than it seems, is it has to do with the ethical features of the tunnel problem and other problems like it. So in tunnel problems specifically, you have one person in the car. That person's in the right. I designed this problem so that the kid running into the road isn't supposed to be there, right? So according to normal driving rules, there's no legal reason why somebody, in my usage of the law, there's no legal reason why somebody would have to swerve out of the way of this child. It's an unfortunate situation. It's a horrible situation. But there's no legal, even moral imperative necessarily for the person to sacrifice themselves in a normal driving situation. The other tough thing about this, though, and this is really what needs to be, what the tunnel problem raises that classic trolley problems don't, because you can get into this kind of utilitarian consequentialist thinking of the classical trolley problem, is that in the tunnel problem, even in classic trolley problems, there's no obvious objectively correct answer. Not the way that we would say there's an answer to like a calculus question or something. Right? These are hard moral cases. The reason we raise these in philosophy classes is because they're tough moral dilemmas. And what that means is that there's no clear answer. From the driver's perspective anyway, this actually looks like an end-of-life decision. And this is where I'm going to start to pull, if you read the papers that I've written, there's a lot more talk about bioethics and stuff like this. But if you're interested in bioethics, I'm doing this for a reason. It looks like an end-of-life decision. This is the driver, in a classic driving contest, would have to make a decision about whether they hit a child or possibly end their own life. So if we borrow from that classic driving context where the person is behind the wheel, the driver appears to have the moral authority to decide how the car reacts because of all these features. Okay, so let's re-examine these questions. If we accept that those are the features of this problem, those features on the previous slide, question one is going to start looking like a deeply personal moral problem that somebody has to solve. And so, given that, we can start to look at question two as a problem, like a real problem. And what do I mean by that? Well, if the engineers assume moral authority in this situation and program the car, regardless of the particular decision they make, I argue that it's going to start looking like a paternalistic, classically paternalistic decision. And so I say that we can start looking at the car in that situation like it's holding a proxy decision for somebody. Okay, and we can start asking questions like who should it be making decisions on behalf of this car? So I say that, we can model these types of technological systems when we're automating ethical decision making and there are these tough moral problems involved. We can model that robot as what I would call a technological moral proxy, right? Somebody's going to have to write code that makes decisions on behalf of someone else, sometimes these tough decisions. Excuse me. The good thing is that we have places to look if we want to use this type of literature or this type of model, the moral proxy model. We can look elsewhere to gain some traction on this problem. How do we understand who a moral proxy should be making decisions on behalf of? This literature is well established in health. Okay, so the bioethics literature is very specific about who gets to make these deeply personal moral decisions on behalf of other people. And ideally, it's the person, you look to the person who's interests are at stake. So in healthcare, it's the patient we're talking about. And the moral proxy makes a decision on behalf of that person in their best interest. not in the best interest of the hospital, not in the best interest of the physicians, in the best interest of that individual. And so I think we can import a lot of the norms that we have surrounding moral proxies in healthcare to inform the design decisions that go on with robotics and artificial intelligence. And this is what I call the moral proxy model. And we can use it to inform an analysis of the automation of ethical decision making. Okay, so generally the kind of the norms that it would suggest is that when we're automating ethical decision making in any system, we should avoid paternalistic design decisions for the same reasons that we avoid paternalism in healthcare. And that informed consent models can help mitigate paternalism by design. So when you're designing the car to react in the tunnel problem, or problems like it, we cannot just default without taking into consideration the people in the car or whoever is the proper person to be making that decision. It seems like the designers, the engineers are not that person. They should not be making that decision. Okay? So that's the upshot. The moral proxy analogy suggests something about what engineers can and can't decide to do. They don't have the moral decision-making authority in all cases. That may seem obvious or something like that, but when you go and you talk to engineers, when I talk to engineers, they don't think like this. They think in terms of it being their technology, it being their design, and they can do what they want with it. And that's troublesome. It could be a problem for more reasons than just they don't want to give up their turf. So I work with the Open Roboethics Initiative. It's a collaboration between engineers, designers, philosophers, policymakers. We have a bunch of different people in this organization. And what we do is we engage the public to try to get some understanding of how they feel about certain issues in robotics and artificial intelligence. So we actually posed the tunnel problem to a bunch of readers on robohub.org, which is a popular website for people who are interested in these things. And here are the questions we asked. So, first question, you find yourself as the passenger in a tunnel problem, how should the car react? So this is like, how would you want the car to react, right? And I thought the split was interesting. So swerve and kill the passenger. 36% of respondents actually decided that self-sacrifice was the option that they would take. I was surprised at that number. We had a little over 100 people respond. But this wasn't the interesting thing. This was predictable. How hard? Well, actually, the easy I found surprising. So I don't know. 48% of people said that this was an easy problem to solve. Okay. I don't know what to make of that. I put this slide up because we tried to gauge. You know, did you think about it? Did it take you a while to come up with your answer? But this I found interesting and telling. When asked who should determine, so this is the second question that I raised in the context of these technologies, who should determine how the car responds to the tunnel problem? 12% of people said the designer or the manufacturer. Right? The passenger, because of the setup, this is the, I think, predictable answer, the 44%. What I was surprised at is this other option we gave them, lawmakers. So we asked them, why did you respond the way that you did in that previous question? We got answers like this. We feel that the passenger should make the decision because things like freedom of choice, it's my car, I get to make the decision, I own that car, I don't trust technology, the passenger's the most affected. So it starts to line up a little bit with the moral proxy model, I think. Lawmakers, they said, so this was interesting. It's a legal issue. Lawmakers allow for fair decisions. We need universal rules. Lawmakers allow democratic decisions. There was this appeal to the legitimacy of the process that would go into creating the rules so that, in a sense, people who chose that the manufacturer should be making the decision felt it was because they have the expertise to make those decisions. Now, I want to argue, in fact, my entire argument is all about how they just don't have that expertise. This is a different kind of expertise, right? Making an ethical decision, these kind of hard cases, it's not like deciding how an acceleration should happen or something like that. Because there's no objectively correct answer. There's no appeal to the kind of expertise that you would appeal to to solve a technical problem. I would say that that's putting your faith in the wrong kind of expertise. Okay, so what does this data tell us about the design of these automated ethical decision-making processes? I think it reinforces the notion that the tunnel problem poses a hard moral case. It's clearly one of these cases. It indicates that the moral proxy analogy, I think, might be a useful model, at least, for ethically evaluating automated ethical decision making. The kind of terminology that people use to describe who should be making these decisions lines up with the kind of explanations and arguments we get, at least in the bioethics literature. It reinforces, and this is important, it reinforces the notion of a hard limit on engineers or designers' moral authority at the drawing board. They can't just make all decisions about their technology. And these aren't the technical problems they're solving when they automate that decision. And it also complicates the design and governance challenges, obviously. If you're imposing limits on what engineers can do at the drawing board, they need some sort of solution so that they can design these systems. So let's get back to these classics, right? These unavoidable crash scenarios, they require value trade-offs. Some of them are going to require population-based solutions. So this is the lawmaker side. It looks like one of the things that we need to focus on is getting away from the individual model, because it's not realistic to give people the decision in the moment with these systems. We may have to look to population-based systems, like public regulation, and things like that, like publicly available information. Because what we're going to see is in real driving scenarios, other people. I mean, this is these are scenarios that other people have thought up. So you can see that you're in a situation where there's a large number of people versus one person. This looks a lot like the classic trolley problem, right? You're going to have to code for these kind of things. This one here is a lot like the tunnel problem, single person versus the driver. Excuse me. And then a lot of people versus the driver. So variations on a theme. But you can imagine, people have come up with problems like, the car can brake in time. There are two cyclists in your way that swerve into your way. One of them has a helmet, one of them doesn't have a helmet. Should the car hit the person with the helmet or without the helmet? Right? Do you penalize the person who's wearing the helmet because there's a greater likelihood that they'll survive the impact? I mean, all sorts of scenarios that people have thought of that are quite probable in driving situations. And these things happen. There are other, again, I don't want you to think that this is just limited to driverless cars. There are all sorts of other scenarios with robotics and artificial intelligence that are going to require these same top moral decision making to be automated. Privacy settings are one that we've grappled with a lot. So Facebook, you can think of their privacy settings as automating privacy. You click a bunch of settings, and then it automates the flow of information around the internet, right, on Facebook. Social interactions in robotics. Things like when you have these robots that are interacting with people, like Jibo that I showed you earlier, when can you engage in deception? Can you ever engage in deception? How do you manage trust or the trustworthiness of the system in your design? Ditch algorithms for aerial drones. So these things are flying over populated areas. If one of them starts to malfunction and you have a choice to ditch in the field or the playground or the road or the playground or the schoolyard or the building, how do you decide which way to ditch? Somebody has to decide that. There's this idea of geofencing algorithms for aerial drones. So should you put up these invisible barriers in the software so that these drones can't physically fly into certain areas? Who gets to choose where those fences are? Do we all get a say in that? Is it the designers? Is it the government? You can also imagine non-critical settings in autonomous vehicles, like environmental settings, whether or not you're able to turbo boost and get like rapid acceleration because you like the feel of it, even though that burns more fuel. Little things like that. How do you program those decisions into these automobiles? Like, should anyone have a choice? Should you be able to get to your destination sooner than somebody else? How do you decide? More to get that privilege. Is it a privilege? And then designing for meaningful human control of automated weapons. So there's more and more of a push to automate these military drones so they can kill by themselves. How do you design for that? How much do you keep the person in the loop so that they're controlling who gets killed and when? These are all similar types of situations that are going to require these design methodologies. And it's not clear that the engineers are in any position to make these kinds of decisions. And many engineers don't want to make these decisions, right? They're looking for people to help them with this stuff. So, starting to wrap up, we're increasingly going to have to automate ethical decision making. I hope that last slide was a little bit of an indication of that. Also, think again about having these robots out in the world just interacting with people. When we automate ethical decision making, we must relinquish some moral control, right? So these decisions are going to have to be made by the software many times. So how can we relinquish, getting back to the title of the talk, how can we relinquish moral control and feel good about it? Feel like we've done it the right way? Well, the argument that I make in the work that I'm doing right now focuses on developing processes, so these are design processes, through which we relinquish that control in the right cases to the right individuals. And what do I mean by that? We can develop design processes that help to identify and manage the automation of ethical decision making. There's a model that a number of people that work in this area are interested in. It's called the embedded ethicist model. So similar to the kinds of the kinds of functions that like an environmental engineer brings to the table when we get concerned about sustainability and green technologies, you can bring people in with that particular expertise to identify cases where you're automating ethical decision making and help to navigate that design process, come up with standard tools, processes to help with that that whole design. The other thing is that you can increase the role that informed consent plays in the design or regulatory activities. So informed consent can be like publicly, like a publicly posted regulation or like public knowledge about how algorithms work in particular situations or types of situations. So this is transparent and anticipatory regulatory approaches. So that Google can't, Google or BMW, I won't pick on Google, but they make the most of their technology. So, and I've been in the room with them, and they don't talk a lot about the technology. So getting them to open up the code a little bit so that people understand what's going on in these certain types of circumstances seems like a good first step. Google has a robot ethics board. It's all behind closed doors. They don't reveal what kinds of activities they're doing. But you could have this kind of ethics review in industry that helps to standardize these processes. So design ethics standards as well. I'm involved in this right now with the IEEE, so they've just started to work towards ethics design standards for robotics and artificial intelligence. Also, there are options for ethics settings for users in low-stakes cases, so not in a tunnel problem, right? You're probably not going to have a car. where you get in and set it, whether it's going to, you know, sacrifice you or children, that kind of thing. But these kind of low-stakes cases, like the kind of cases where you're maybe having a slightly greater impact on the environment, but within, within acceptable levels, that you can be more or less environmentally friendly and still be environmentally friendly overall in terms of the regulations. So these are some of the ideas that I'm working on, some of the things that are going on in industry right now, just in the early stages. So, getting back to the concerns that Elon Musk and these folks have, these approaches aren't going to eliminate those concerns, but certainly worrying about the superintelligence right now is a little bit distant. And if we don't develop these kinds of techniques for doing the ethics up front, then we're definitely going to have a problem later on. At least these are a first step towards increasing that kind of control, at least in the design process, so that we have taken a good step forward. Just to wrap things up, some of the current, like these are the two particular projects that I'm working on, developing this kind of design framework that I talked about for the embedded ethicist model, and also categorizing these types of ethics settings. So I have a paper that's going to be coming out in a couple months. Well, actually, probably about a year. I'll probably be done in a couple months, but publishing takes so long. Ethics settings for autonomous vehicles to help sort of sort through the high stakes versus the low stakes cases. So this is like, when I look around in industry, there are a few people that are starting to tackle this. It's a really interesting area. I know most of you are senior students here. This is a growth area in philosophy. We don't have many of those. This is certainly one. So I'm happy to take questions from you, and I'll be around for the next hour at least. So thank you. Yeah, sure. If you want to field the questions, I'll just take them. That way they can blame you.
Sure.
You find it difficult to, for us to gain, high level of benefit, you don't totally relinquish control to automation. I kind of really disagree with that, because I feel like going into the extreme on either end is not gaining complete benefit. Usually sort of finding that middle way, that's when you gain the most benefit. So can you elaborate your reason on that statement? And,
So I was trying to hedge there, right? Like I was trying to say that, we have to give up some control, not all control. So it's important that I want to stay back from the edge as well, right? Like I don't want to go running over the cliff. But we have to give up all control for all benefits. The challenge, though, is that if we are, so there is this trade-off with a lack of predictability. And a lack of predictability doesn't mean necessarily a lack of safety or increased risk. It may actually be the case that having less predictability, having less control, ends up being the safer, less riskier option. But it's hard to sort of generalize, I guess. But I don't want to suggest that we should just be accepting blindly that we should be giving up control, but there is that trade-off, at least with these new algorithms. I mean, we will. So, for example, the flash crash of the stock market a few years ago now, right? Trading starts in the morning, and then within minutes it halts for some unknown reason. Values of commodities are all over the place for some reason. Nobody knows why. So that's a perfect example of a situation where we're not in control of that system. The system shut itself down, did a bunch of stuff. I think it took 2 or 3 days for them to start to figure out what happened. So we can, so lack of control, lack of predictability also doesn't mean that we can't understand what happened after the fact. It doesn't mean that the system can't have systems that are going into the cars aren't designed really, they weren't designed specifically with security in mind. I mean, who's going to hack an entertainment system in a Ford, right? But then what ends up happening is, like, you know, whoever makes that system, I can't remember the name of the company, there's one company that makes a huge number of entertainment systems. You know, they start selling it to more car companies, and then the entertainment system, because it's got these processors in there, they start using it as the central system to kind of control other aspects of the car. The engineers kind of, you know, oh, well, we can use this to kind of hook it up here. And then, like, you've got ignition going, like, you know, the ignition time, the control of the engine and ignition, everything is all locked into the system, and people have quite successfully been able to hack these systems with surprising regularity, to put it that way. There's a concern out there, but it's still not common practice in industry for car companies to be designing security in their software and hardware systems from the ground up. So it's a slow process getting industry to recognize, like, what needs the, you know, the kind of end-to-end solutions that they need from, like, you know, you need to be teaching people about this in school, right? People, most engineers should be taking security courses standard as part of their program. They don't. I don't know what they teach here, but it's just not normal in an engineering program. So it's a slow process to change. People are concerned about it, but the solutions are lagging behind the risks, unfortunately.
One of the issues I saw that you kept bringing up was that, you know, the computer can't make an ethical decision like a person can. And I noticed that, you know, you kept bringing up the idea where it was pretty much an end-all, be-all. You either take someone out or you take yourself out. Whereas, you know, a human makes a decision, okay, well, maybe I can just wreck the car. Maybe I can swerve around them, maybe not hit them, stuff like that. And I feel like unless you get to the point where the computer can think and make decisions like a human, you can't really have a completely autonomous car.
Yeah, so you can certainly program the car to react somehow in the tunnel problem or any other problem, right? Let's say the engineers say, classic trolley problem, you've got five people on the road, you've got one person on the sidewalk, you can't brake for whatever reason, like the brakes have failed, I need to go into emergency evasive mode here. Well, it's a simple numbers game. I'm going to hit that one person on the side of the road and save the five. This is a classic solution to a problem, right? What engineers would be fooling themselves into believing is that they've come up with the right answer. The reason is that we don't talk that way in ethics, right? What you've done in that situation where you've chosen to hit the one person instead of the five is you've adopted a consequentialist or utilitarian mode of problem solving, and you've applied that type of problem solving to this problem. But there's no way to say that is the, you know, you shouldn't have adopted some other ethical problem solving approach to that particular problem. These cases aren't like that. Even the low stakes case, like, I like when the car accelerates really quickly, as opposed to just kind of like a gradual, boring acceleration. So I'm going to set that thing to accelerate quickly. Setting it to accelerate quickly versus setting it to accelerate slowly, you might even classify that as one of these, as two options that you can't really compare on even ground. In the one case, it's like environmental concerns are at play. In the other case, it's what I like to feel when I accelerate in the car. There's no way of weighing those things against each other in a numerical, objective way. So that's So when I say that, and so this is a kind of problem that philosophers who work in ethics, Ruth Chang in particular, would point to and say, like, these are just what she classifies as hard moral cases. They're cases where four people might have different opinions about, like, they might come to different solutions about what's right for them, but there's no way of objectively comparing who made the best decision. And a lot of ethical problems turn out to be that type of problem. So these are, so the illustration is just to, so explaining all of that philosophical stuff is just the ammunition to say, look, engineers, you know, we may think we're doing the right thing, but really we're just doing the same. And it's not right like a technical problem, like a technical solution is right, like where you engage exactly what you're trying to do. Like in this case, I want to maximize efficiency. I figured out how to maximize efficiency. Ethical problems are something different. The worry is that, so when we go through school as engineers, we don't spend a lot of time being taught philosophy. So we're not really sensitive to that kind of thinking. You can mistake these things for technical problems when in fact they're not. Does that help? Does that answer your question?
Thank you very much.
So it's in regard to exactly what you were just saying. I think that what we're looking at is more of a human aspect, where we have free will. We can make the choice to intervene where we didn't create something. I think a computer should have to be challenged to not making decisions based on something that it didn't decide to do. So in the trolley problems, you're making the decision whether this trolley, because you had nothing to do with the trolley, you didn't tie the people to the tracks. You're making the decision whether that trolley kills five people or one person. I'm saying that the car had nothing to do with making that decision, so it should just continue on its course the way it was pre-programmed. So if it didn't cause that, if it didn't cause the reason why it was going to hit somebody, it should just hit them. It's rigid. If it caused it by overspeeding and going too fast, then that's a problem with programming. But I think rigidly the computer needs to not react.
So the challenge is that most unfortunate driving situations will not be, they'll fall into that category, but you'll still have to program the car to do something. Right? I mean, that's what you're describing as a choice. That's what gets programmed into the car, right? So as a design problem, you're still faced with making some sort of decision about how to design the car, right? So now, let's say you go and you make your claim and you go before a congressional hearing that's trying to decide, I don't know, how to regulate, whoever does the regulation, however they decide to do it, however they decide as an industry, and you say, look, any situation, we're just going to brake hard and keep going straight, hope for the best. Well, I mean, then at least everybody that gets into a driverless car knows that if something flies into the road in front of that driverless car, all that car is going to do is brake hard, right? But if we have different car companies coming up with different solutions, and you get into the car with no idea how that car has been programmed to respond to those types of situations. That's what I'm more concerned about.
That's why I'm saying we need to rigidly.
Yeah. So then I think you're drinking my Kool-Aid, right? So now you're talking about like these kind of like open, transparent design decisions that everybody knows about. We can all walk around the world saying like, yeah, that's cars just brake hard. That's what they do. They don't swerve, they don't do anything. So, you know, let's make the front ends a little longer. We need twice the crumple zone and not Mommy's car.
Basically, what I noticed when you were talking, which is what I was thinking about, was well, you could go on and on about hypothetical situations, but one thing is like, let's say it does come out, and most people are driving automated vehicles. get into an accident with somebody who was actually operating the vehicle, what could it turn into where I'm passenger, I say, oh, well, I wasn't driving, how is this my fault?
Yeah, so the insurance industry does not know what to do with driverless cars. Everything that I've assumed in this talk relies on a kind of classic understanding of driving,
yeah.
Right? So let's say I get into the car, it's not even my car, right? I have an app, like an Uber app, and I push the button and some car pulls up, picks me up and starts driving me somewhere. I'm in the back seat, I'm not even paying attention, right? Maybe there are four of us in the car, none of us are paying attention. What then, right? I don't even own the car, I'm renting it, I'm licensing it. Yeah, no, I mean, so it's such a disruptive technology for the legal system, the insurance system, like engineering, so many questions that are unsolved. I'll be giving a talk to the insurance industry out on the West Coast of Canada later in the summer. They have no idea what to do with this, right? When I go, I've participated in two workshops at Stanford with people who are interested in designing these cars. Google's been there, like they're in the room. When they show up, it's their lawyers mostly that show up. Because the lawyers are the ones who are kind of shaking their heads, right? Like the Ford lawyers show up, like BMW, you know, their head of engineering, and a couple lawyers. Because they're all kind of looking around the room trying to figure out what does it even mean to have liability in these kinds of situations? Like what counts as a design defect in these kinds of situations? Like wait, they don't know what to do with it. A lot of times, you know, in terms of the legal aspects, these things get decided after the fact, right? The law reacts to situations. So we may have to wait until these things actually happen before, and you know, cases come to the courts and there are appeals and it works its way up through the system before we start to get an understanding of how the laws work. Regulation is a different thing, right? We can regulate proactively. Hopefully that's what people will do. Maybe, you know, you can regulate to make it clear who will bear more liability in certain situations. So it may be, and I think the industry is looking for that kind of solution as well. They're looking to the governments to say, like, we need guidance on this before these things come out because we don't want to all of a sudden be on the hook. We don't want to have a fleet of a million cars out there and find out that every one of those things is like a multi-million-dollar lawsuit waiting to happen. And we could have solved this problem beforehand if we'd gotten some guidance from the industry. But it's kind of a mess. It's very disruptive, and nobody really knows. Yeah, these were early days. Something has changed in the last 2 to 3 years that is enabling this new way of solving these really what used to be impossible programming challenges. People just had no way of solving these things prior to these new deep learning algorithms coming in. So I think you're absolutely right that it changes the way we have to even talk about what it means to program for these scenarios. Because I suspect that if you talk to, the conversation would be something like that. If you're talking to a deep learning programmer, like somebody question would be about, well, what kind of data sets do we have to generate to give, to teach this thing what types of responses would count as ethical? I mean, we're always going to run into the same problem with teaching someone ethics, right? And those of us who try to teach ethics, we realize that you kind of teach a bunch of different ways of thinking about ethics, and then individuals go off and they live the lives that they live. It's different than teaching engineering, where you get a bunch of students in a room and you say, this is how we solve these types of problems. This is how we solve these types of problems. Like, one of the things you grapple with as an ethics prof is getting people comfortable with not having answers to anything. That takes a long time. And some people never get there. It's very frustrating. So that, I think, is a main part of it's going to be a huge challenge, even if we get the technical, like, well, what kind of, we need to generate data sets. Maybe then you have to standardize the type of data sets or standard problems that you're feeding into this system. How does the there's so many questions. I mean, nobody has the answers to these things yet, but these are all the types of things that I would say in the next 5-10 years, people are going to be spending a lot of time doing today. Because everybody's going to start using these deep learning algorithms. They're just so efficient. So if you look online, you can find videos of successful deep learning projects. So one of the things that engineers have been doing for AI, AI research has been doing with deep learning, is teaching computers how to play old Atari video games. Because they're relatively simple, it's like a relatively constrained system. So something like Pac-Man or Breakout. Breakout's the classic, right? You know, the one where you're moving along the bottom, there's a little ball going up, you've got to break all the tiles on the top. I used to play that game all the time. So they used Breakout to teach, and they generated a huge data set of people playing Breakout. Well, then they gave the system, like they gave the deep learning system all the information about how to play Breakout. And the system got really good at playing Breakout. Figured out all the best strategies to kind of get the ball up, so bouncing on it. For those of you who play Breakout, you know what I'm talking about. I won't go on too much. You can find these things online. One of the things that the researchers consistently say is that the computers come up with solutions to problems that they've never seen before. The computers surprise them all the time. And they come up with really efficient, good solutions to problems like Breakout. So that says something about the nature of this programming that you can't say about deterministic programming, like a functional line-by-line program where you're telling a computer exactly how to do something. It's a different kind of activity here.
I mean, you sort of touched on this a little more, and people made similar comments, some the opposite of mine, but again, what we seem to keep coming back to is that the only way to really, get a car which is capable of driving by itself, as opposed to having a human driver, is to gather, large data sets. And, when you're a human driver, you can make one of a million decisions when you're driving. You can, and a million combinations of those, and so on and so forth. So you have billions of possible outcomes when, you're driving your car. It seems like, again, without something that, like a supercomputer in a car that's capable of making all these calculations, it doesn't seem possible to have a self-driving car, because we're focusing too much on the ethical limitations of the car. We're thinking, okay, well, ethically, it makes more sense for it to do this than this, where I feel like it should be looking at it more statistically, where it goes, okay, well, I have an adult driver in the car, I can try to aim the car to hit the passenger side where there's no one. Yeah, I have a higher chance of, killing the driver, but the person in the middle of the road is fine. So,
right.
I mean...
So what you're talking about is a very particular way of approaching solving that problem. So you could imagine algorithms that maximize the well-being of the person or persons in the car. You could imagine algorithms that minimize the overall damage to the most number of vehicles on the road. You could imagine algorithms that are taught to minimize the insurance liability in any given situation. So say you know that one driver's uninsured or something like that, and the other person's totally insured, maybe you'll sort of like do the maximum damage to that person's car. Who knows? You could imagine, again, like, but running through these scenarios, these are all just different strategies for solving these problems, none of which you can compare easily to the other one, right? So which is the best strategy? Minimizing harm to the passengers in the car, minimizing liabilities to the company. Like, it's hard to make these decisions.
That's what I'm saying, though.
The decisions need to be made.
The decisions that you keep bringing up, though, you're saying that, you know, we'll have a data set or something that would be able to help the computer make the decision. What I'm saying is, unless you have a supercomputer, you know, a super intelligent AI running the car that can, you know, look at all of the data sets at the exact same time and can, you know, put the perfect combination together, you really can't have a self-driving car because it won't be able to make the decision which best suits the situation. It has to be able to analyze the data in the world around it,
right,
along with other variables. And there are just too many in the natural world.
Oh, so are you saying that the possibility of a self-driving car is minimal? Like, it's not really a possibility?
It's not that it's impossible. It's just that, you know, you're saying that the best way we've been thinking about doing it is to, you know, not have something that's super intelligent to, you know, make it so that, you know, we don't have to, you know, in order for the computer to make these moral decisions that we keep bringing up, we're saying that, you know, a super intelligent computer may not be the best choice, and we're worried about it, you know, ending humanity, as, you know, Elon Musk and other people are saying. But without the super intelligence, it seems like the self-driving car is an impossibility.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well, I mean, Google, I think that industry representatives would probably disagree that you need something like super intelligence to run these cars. I mean, they're out there, right? These cars are driving around right now. They're just expensive, so they're not on the market. And there are other issues, like who's going to insure them, all that. Like, there are the regulatory issues that we haven't solved yet, but certainly the car companies, they won't. I mean, I don't think that you need super intelligence. It's not super intelligence, it's just a different kind of problem solving. It's problem solving.